praise the Lord, everyone. One time a man was at work and this lady was in a battle, and she looked at this man and said, "I see you smiling." And she said, he said to her, "Don't you understand? Tonight is Thursday. We got church tonight. And no matter what we're going through, we can come and get the victory direct from heaven." What about you? Aren't you shouting that there's church tonight? Jesus, we praise you and worship you. And we ask you now to move in our midst. Go ahead and praise him and give God the glory. And thank him for that wonderful love. Come on in to the house of the Lord. Come on into his presence. Come and dine at the table that God has set. Come and dine and rejoice in the spiritual things. God has the victory for you. All you've got to do is receive and just let Jesus stir in your heart. Heavenly Father, we praise you and worship you. Let's sing as the brother comes to me.
Jesus has a table spread where the saints of God are fed. He invites his chosen people, come and dine. With this manna he to feed and supplies our every need. His sweet to sup with Jesus all the time. Come and dine, the master called him, come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table all the time. He who fed the multitude, turned the water into wine. To the hungry call him now, come and dine. The disciples came to land, thus obeying Christ's command. For the master called him to
He's got your answer tonight. Praise God. Amen. You may be seated. This time, I want the ushers to come. Let's receive the Thursday night offering and tithe. And I'm thankful for that heavenly call one day. You know, there are a lot of times when we were younger, we used to go out looking for all kinds of stuff. We wanted to be invited to places. But I was thankful that day I got invited to church. I got invited to know Jesus. That is everything. Amen. So let's pray. Let's receive the tithe and offering as unto the Lord. Brother, if you'll pray. Aren't you glad for that day he brought you out? What did he bring you out for? So that the Spirit of God could fall fresh upon your life. Let the Spirit of God fall fresh upon you tonight.
Oh, Christ the King, everything to you. Oh, Christ the King is my everything. I give my life to you. Christ the King, my everything to you.
Be seated. Hurry, hurry. No, not really. Don't hurry. Do not hurry. Man, seeing Jessica fly down those steps in high heels, that's something right there. All right, fix this for me, would you please? I don't want to hold on to it if I don't have to, because it's not something that smells particularly good. It's amazing. All right. That goes right along with this message tonight. That we know that God really wants us to give him our all. It's amazing how universally known that is, even though the knowledge may not be in the head of the person. There's an inner sense that God wants all of me. Everyone knows you can't give him just part. But we'll see. Maybe you'll see more as we go along here. I'm in Matthew 24, and I want to take it out of its context tonight because it's about end time events. It's not about the church right now. It was Jesus teaching Jews about Jewish matters. But let's read it. And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? Tell us about Revelation. I want to use this verse 3 as a text tonight. He sat up on the Mount of Olives. The disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us. And I want to preach about this title. Curiosity doesn't kill everyone. The old saying is, curiosity killed the cat, but satisfaction brought him back. Contrary to popular belief, cats do not have 9 lives. Contrary to Catholic belief, you do not go to purgatory when you die. You don't get 2 chances any more than the cat gets 9. Curiosity may have gotten a few cats killed. Satisfaction never brought any of them back. Because getting killed isn't exactly what you'd call satisfaction. But the disciples were essentially preachers in the making. But they were concerned about the wrong thing. When they came to the Lord, their concern was about the temple. They looked at some of the most magnificent yet largest stones that had ever been confiscated throughout the Roman Empire and brought into Jerusalem. And some said that some of these rocks were even maybe 50 feet long. I don't know, but they were huge. And they said, tell us when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of your coming? And what's the sign of the end of the world? This is what they wanted to know. But they were concerned about the wrong thing. They were easily fascinated by these end time events. They were fascinated by the massive temple in Jerusalem. And Jesus was unimpressed. For when they said, look, Master, another gospel records more detail about it. Look at the stones of this temple. And he said, they're all going to be thrown down to the ground. This temple's going to be destroyed. And in fact, that was one of the things that bothered people when Jesus said, destroy this temple. And in 3 days, I will rebuild it again. What did that mean? Of course, they knew that it took decades to build that temple. And Jesus is saying, I can rebuild it in 3 days. To them, it meant, I'm God, and I can put this thing back together in 3 days. But that's not what he meant. What he was talking about was, we'll get rid of this earthly thing that man has built, that you're so impressed with, and in 3 days, when I rise from the dead, I will build a real church. And it won't be one made with man's hands. This is one that was born in the heart of God, and God will bring it to pass. He said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So they were fascinated, that's true, but Jesus, unimpressed, predicted its destruction. And that destruction came to pass in 70 AD at the hands of a Roman conqueror. Let's talk first about curiosity for a few minutes. Curiosity killed the cat, the old proverb says. But what that meant was not necessarily that, like one guy told us, we visited this redneck fellow one day. He was a real thing. You don't believe me. You don't believe these people really exist.
That's a racial slur.
Redneck isn't a race. At least, I don't think. What's a redneck? Well, you figure it out. Someone with a red neck. There's a screen up here. I can see that my neck. It's a little bit red. Just a little bit. Now, like Reverend Fausto, for example, that's a Montana redneck. The pistol shooting, biscuit eating, hat wearing, all around American. Amen. So we all have our strangeness, but not that that's strange. I come from the land of the ball cap wearing, deer hunting, snowmobiling rednecks. And I hope none of my family are listening in online tonight. Well, I hope they are, actually. And there's a few other Michiganders here, too, tonight. But the redneck said, he was talking about this, well, let me save it for just a second. When you're being inquisitive about other people's affairs is what it means. That's what this curiosity killed the cat is about. It's a phrase meaning you're inquisitive about other people's business and it might get you into trouble. But curiosity's not a bad thing, really. It's not a bad thing. It has made the world what it is today. If it wasn't for curiosity, we may not have cures for diseases. I'm talking about the old days when they actually really tried to do that. And if it wasn't for curiosity, we wouldn't have had space travel and research and development, and you wouldn't have your cell phone to peep at during church, and you know, all these things that we would not have. Good or bad, it's curiosity that caused mankind to investigate, experiment, research, come up with all the good and bad things that we've come up with. Curiosity. It means really not something that gets you killed. It's not only being a busybody in someone's affairs, but it is really just a strong desire to know and to learn. That's what curiosity is. I want to know, like I said that one time, I want to know what's inside this fan. It was an antique oscillating fan, which you'd probably like to have in your house right now. And it was really cool. It was a really old one, like from the 50s. And I said, man, I want to see what's inside of this. There's a problem with it. It doesn't work. And I'm going to take it apart and see what makes this thing tick. It was a curiosity of a young man. And so I tore it apart. When I got done, I had about 10 extra parts left over, and it still didn't work, so I threw it away. But curiosity didn't kill me, but it did satisfy my desire, which was to find out that there was nothing inside of it but garbage. In the old days, I remember how Pastor Davis would be at fellowship, and I remember how we used to get around that table and sit there and listen to him talk about God, ask him questions about God. There were always those at the table who would ask dumb questions. They would ask dumb questions, trying to bring some kind of fire on somebody else. Pastor, what do you think of people who pick their nose at the table? Knowing that the brother next to them does that, and hoping that somehow something would be said that would correct him, instead of just, why didn't the brother just say to him, well, quit picking your nose? But they like to use that passive-aggressive approach to everything. And he wanted to use the pastor as some kind of bombardier and give him coordinates to bombard the other brother and ask a question. I like one time we had this guy, we called him Mr. Practical Theology. He was real nice, nasty, you know, and all, everything had to be perfect and pristine. He probably toothbrushed his fingernails and who knows what all he did. And his hair had to be just perfect and everything. And he was always criticizing everybody else who wasn't as perfect and pristine as he was. And so I had a room in the dorm, and it was a converted kitchen. I had my own kitchen, my own sink, right in my room. Twin bed, what could be better? We didn't have any air conditioning. That was St. Louis, 90-some percent humidity in the summer. So quit griping. And I let the brothers use the sink. You know, if the bathroom was taken, you could come in here and brush your teeth, wash your face if you want to. So he starts telling me, you know, I think that when people, you know, come in there and use the sink, I think that everybody should scrub the sink out with Comet. I said, what? He said, yes, I think everybody should scrub the sink out with Comet each time they use it. I said, it's my sink. Don't use it if you don't want to. I'm not doing that. What are you, crazy? Get out of here, don't you? So we're in orientation one night. And he stands up and says, Pastor Davis, sir, what do you think about brothers who brush their teeth in the sink and then don't scrub it out with Comet? Pastor Davis looked at him through those eyebrows and said, sit down. Yes. Hallelujah. We used to love to hear him talk about the Bible and get him going on things about the Word of God, because we had a strong desire to know about the Word of God. I wonder if God could give us more students like that, that wanted to know more about God than they did their girlfriend, that wanted to know more about God than they did the next sandwich coming out of the kitchen. The only questions I ever get is about, we do this, is this okay, is that okay? What am I, God? No. And we live in a world where preachers think they're God. A couple of folks came to the fence one day, and it was that bunch that just got busted by the FBI. A couple of them came to the fence one day, and I walked out to see what they were doing out by our chapel, and they said, see, he's a homosexual. They pointed at me. I said, dude, if there's one thing I've never been, that's it. I'm alpha all the way, no beta. And he said, and all the guys in that church are homosexuals. He's pointing his finger at this chapel. So what is wrong with this human being if that's what he is? And he was telling, he had a van load of kids from their church. This is a church from over here in Tacoma. And brought them out there to show them this and to tell them that we're all a bunch of homosexuals, he said. So what in the world's wrong? And he said, well, you know. And the girl pulled out her telephone. It was, what was her name, Wendy, and what's his name? Jim. Jim and Wendy. They were out there. And I said, I was saying something, and the name of the big man came up, Little Baby Doc. The head of the cult. His name came up. And I said, what? And she pulled out her phone and started recording it. She wanted to get me on record.
She said, you know what? You know, there's only one man of God left on the face of the earth.
I said, oh, really? I said, who's that? She told me his name. I said, what? He's not a man of God. He's a devil. I said, he'll never see the guest. You're recording this? Good. Tell him I said that he'll never see heaven until he restores all the tens of thousands of dollars he embezzled and makes right all the lies that he told and the people he destroyed. That's a cult. And there's someone I talked to just recently by text who was in it, said that he literally teaches his people that they can't get to God unless they go through him. He said, you're probably laughing right now, but I kid you not. I said, I'm not laughing. That is a cult. See, a cult is a word people use these days like they use the word racist. You're a Nazi. You're a racist. You're a misogynist. Any woman that isn't allowed to do what she wants by her husband considers him a misogynist. You're a misogynist. I never gave you a massage. What are you talking about? Oh, but when they get authoritative and tell you what to do, what does that make them? A misogynist? They can boss you around. They can be authoritative. They can run the family. They can jack up the husband. They can hit him in the head with a rolling pin. But if he says anything like, this is what we're going to do, oh, you're just a bossy, controlling husband. Let me do the bossing and controlling. Yes, dear. How are we doing so far? You don't like it, do you? Me telling it straight doesn't mean a cult. Because I point people to Jesus, not me. And when I throw you under the bus, I roll under the bus with you when I preach. We're all wrong when we're wrong. There's none of us that is God and none of us that is above the gospel. But Jesus Christ is God. And it's he that said that no one can come to God without going through him. You can't go through me to get to God. Now, I might pray for you. You might ask me something. I might guide you in the scriptures. That's my job. But it's not my job to legislate the Bible. And it's not my job to do any of that except to tell you what it said. And not only what it says, but everything that it implies. Now then, why don't people want to learn today? It's amazing why they don't want to learn. If you're a Christian, you ought to be in that Bible study. Except for the ones who are told they can't go, so it doesn't crowd it out. Students aren't supposed to be there. But what about all the church people? Want to go to the Bible study? Let me give you a verse in just a little while. You already sang about it a little while ago. And I want to tell you about something real quick, okay? This is get it off my chest tonight. That's why they call me Flash Gordon. They don't really call me that. We're going to be out of town come Labor Day. Is it Labor Day coming up? It's Memorial Day. Which one is it? Labor Day. Okay. So if you're planning to have a kid, that's the day you need to pay attention to. So we're having a little get-together for the students because we're not going to be here and we like to have the students over. But do you know what RSVP means? Répondez, s'il vous plaît. You know? Anybody else know? Students. That means let us know whether you're coming or not. It's tomorrow. Out of about 40 of you, I think 3 replied. So when you get there, we might say, sorry, no more food, bye. Not really. No, we want you to come, but please let her know. Which is a perfect segue. Now, to you, that's something you ride. But for me, it's something to glide us right into the next subject, which is all the preachers out there. We know that we have an audience that tunes in some, a certain percentage, to the services here in Graham. We send out, when we register for the camp meeting coming up this fall, you're supposed to register. We send out hundreds of emails, and maybe a third of them get read. Are we getting more of them read now? Well, we need to check that, because we can't plan the food, we can't make the arrangements unless we know if you're coming or not. When someone invites you, like the song, Come and Dine, the Master calleth, come and dine. You don't want it to be like that Jesus talked about, where he invited everybody to the feast and nobody came. So he invited somebody else. So when someone invites you, let them know, I'm sorry, I can't make it. I made other plans when I found out you were going to have us over, and so we got it. And it's really rude not to. And it's also rude that if someone invites you, to just not come. So we'll take care of it now. In some people, you don't have to worry about them ever inviting anyone, because they don't want anybody invading their little world. But some of us like the fellowship of one another. So a good way to get not invited is to not ever show up. Then people will give up on you. But don't give up. Invite them anyway. Keep inviting, keep inviting. Somebody will come to your house and your chairs. You don't want to talk about this anymore, I see. Okay. Makes you uncomfortable, I know. Are you coming or not to the conference? If you're coming to the conference this fall, then you need to remember that you don't tread on the campground with the unholy garb. If you're bringing people from your church, tell them that they got to dress right and act right when they are there. Let them know. It's just right to let them know what they're getting into. That's the right thing to do. Talk to the pastor. Find out, how do I prepare for conference? What should I take? How should I dress? Okay, there you go. Curiosity. If people want to learn, you cannot learn without curiosity. This is the fastest way to learn. There is so much available now on the internet, YouTube, which isn't always the best way to learn, but it's there. There's other places, Facebook, you don't learn anything, not much. It depends on who posts what. There's different resources everywhere. I also like a good old book. You may not remember what those are, but it's a thing that has these papers in there, and you thumb through it and you read it on your lap. It's a wonderful thing. It's like a solitude. It's quiet. You don't have the distractions. You don't have notifications popping up in the corner of the page of the book. You don't have an email popping up in the corner, the other corner of the book. You don't have any of that. You can just be you and the book and the quiet outside to sit there and meditate on what you're reading. You don't get as much out of the Bible when you're playing audio driving to work as you do when you sit down and look at the written pages of God's Word to learn about the Lord. And why is it that when we get older in God, we think that learning is over? Should never be over. I've stopped learning about the Lord. I've graduated from Bible school now. I have arrived. Have you? At what? Pride trip. I went by a guy the other day and popped him on the back of the head, and I saw the resentment bristle up because he's full of pride. You can tell these young bucks just surging with testosterone, and iron in their blood and everything. They're so proud, and they're so arrogant, and you can tell by some people how the way they walk. Maybe not quite like that, but their head's so big that you have to grease the pillars of the door to pop them through to get them outside. You really think you're that smart? You're that intelligent? I don't think so. I think if you go there, it's proof that you lack a little bit of intelligence or sense. Let's just say sense. People aren't as uninterested as they pretend to be. They act like they don't have time for church. They don't have time for God. They're not as uninterested as they pretend to be. In fact, many toy with the idea of getting saved, but something holds them back. Something holds them back. Others talk about their good intentions, what they might do someday, or what they think they might follow sometime in the future, but they won't. Because if they really cared about it, they'd be on it right now. They wouldn't postpone the change. The change would be effective immediately, but because they don't really want to change. We don't want to change, and so we don't do anything right now. We just talk about it. Like that girl that said, I would love to be able to play classical piano. And the teacher said, no, you don't. No, you wouldn't. She said, yes, I would. She said, no, you wouldn't, because if you did, you'd be doing it now. What is holding you back? What's keeping you from making that decision for God? Maybe, like the disciples, you get concerned about the wrong thing sometimes. You're too fascinated by the temple to be concerned about what Jesus can teach you. And when we get that way, we tend to obsess on what we're interested in and ignore what we should be interested in, because it is natural to have our heart wherever our treasure is. That's what Jesus said. People say they want nothing to do with Christ, and yet they watch Christians like an eagle watches the prey. They're always looking to find fault. They're looking and expecting something. They justify every wicked deed and promote every wicked deed in the world. And yet, when a Christian does something out of sorts, they'll quickly flag it and say, see, is that what a Christian would do? What would Jesus do? La, 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 la. Because they're not as uninterested as they pretend to be. They know in their heart and mind exactly what God wants and what's not acceptable with the Lord. And they may do backflips and triple twists and turns and forward flips and backflips again to try to say that God's okay with this and this is acceptable and that's acceptable. That doesn't matter. They can go through all that they want to. Deep down in their hearts, all of us know deep within our hearts exactly what God requires of us. We know, we knew before we got saved what we were going to have to do if we really got saved. And it was going to be 100% for God. And that's what one lady said. She wanted to quit the church because she didn't agree with the thing about wearing pants. That's not what it is. It's the real problem is her heart is not 100% to God. If I wore a dress in here, you'd say I was in drag. I'm a drag queen. But if you come in looking like a man, you're not in drag. You're a king of some kind, right? So why does it naturally feel weird to you if I walk in dressed like a woman, my face painted? But the opposite doesn't make you feel weird. Is it not weird, or is it because you got used to it? Which one is it? Can't prove that by the Bible. Okay. But if a person will not examine their heart and their true motives, then they can't be holy. Anyway, holiness comes from the heart and a desire to be right and a sense of humility, modesty, shamefacedness, self-effacing behavior before God. And sometimes we just don't do that, do we? There's a lot of things that aren't itemized in the Bible. And yet, a sinner can tell you something doesn't feel right about that. But a Christian won't tell you that. I don't see anything wrong with it because they want to do it. But a sinner will say, no, I don't feel right about that. Why doesn't he feel right, but Christians feel right? Wait for it. Habakkuk 2:1. I will stand upon my watch. I'm not even wearing a watch. And set me upon the tower and will watch to see what he will say unto me and what I shall answer when I am reproved. I will stand upon my watch like a guard tower and set me upon the tower and will watch to see what God, he will say to me. This represents an eager mind. A hungry heart, one that is saying, I want God to talk to me, and I'm going to wait, and I'm going to watch, and I'm going to listen for him to deal with my heart instead of hastily running off and doing what I tell myself I should do. I want to listen to him. God, what do you want me doing here? Should I be in this place? Should I be doing this activity? Should I be passing my time this way? In Psalm 119, verse 7 through 11, he said, I will praise thee with uprightness of heart. When I shall have learned thy righteous judgments, I will keep thy statutes. Oh, forsake me not utterly. Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. This is learning. This is the open mind. I like what Pastor Kinson said years ago. I never forgot it. He said, how's it go? An open mind is like a parachute. No good unless it's open. If your mind is closed to the truth, and your mind is closed to the word, and you're not eagerly learning more, I'm talking to you that have been saved a while too. Don't shovel it back to somebody you think is new. Because the new person will be more eager to learn usually than the older person in God. You can get all mired down in thinking you know and you've heard just about everything, but when you research the word and you look in there, there's always something new that comes leaping out to your mind. A new and refreshing challenge, a refreshing thought that causes you to be inspired and to be motivated all over again. It's when we don't give God the opportunity to do this that we get stale, like a stale Chips Ahoy cookie. Who wants to eat a stinking, stale Chips Ahoy cookie? Nobody. And who wants to have a stale Chips Ahoy mind? God, give us, as the psalmist prayed for, a soft heart, a willing mind that's ready to learn all that it can get a hold of. Anything you want to do and learn about, you can find the information. And when you're hungry for it, you'll dig it out, you'll mine it out, you'll search it out, you'll document it, you'll read it over and over and over and over because you want to learn. What about learning the Word of God? Jesus said, seek out the book of the law and read it, because in it you think you have eternal life. told the Pharisees that. And that was a nice way of saying, you just think you have eternal life. You just think you're going to heaven. But you need to read the word to make sure. He said in verse 10, with about a third of my heart have I sought thee. It's not on the screen. How do you know? Oh. Oops. With my whole heart have I sought thee. That verse alone is enough sermonics to last a lifetime. Because that's when you get those personal revelations from the Lord. That's when you get real understanding. When your whole heart, not 50%, not 60, not 75, when your entire heart is moving towards seeking Him out and learning about Him, you'll never go wrong. He said, let me not wander from thy commandments. Thy word have I hid in mine heart that I might not sin against thee. Curiosity doesn't kill everyone. Curiosity is what we need. We need to have a hunger to know more and more and more. The curious and those who learn. Point three, Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, you that are weighed down, carrying your burdens, all you that labor and work hard, you that are tired, you that have worn yourselves out, come to me and I'll give you rest, Jesus said. I'll give you rest in your soul, another verse said. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. Instead of carrying that heavy burden that you have, carry my burden, for my burden is easy. Mine is light. The way of the transgressor is hard, and the way of the weighed down burden Christian is hard. But for the one that says, I want to learn more, Lord, I want to help. I want your help in carrying this load. I want you to be yoked up together with me. I want to learn. I want to love you with all my heart, seek you with all my heart, hide your word in my heart, because I don't want to sin against you. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. People who are like Jesus, who are meek and lowly in heart, don't doll themselves up and wave a banner that says, look at me and how pretty I am. Jesus didn't roam through the streets trying to draw attention and get everybody to adore him like some Christians do. The key was he was meek and lowly in heart. He had nothing to be flashy and flamboyant about. Well, he did actually, but he didn't want to be, because it wasn't within the nature of God and the Holy Ghost. And that's the thing you can't relate to, is the way that people display certain appetites and attitudes and these kinds of things that just don't coincide with the virtues of God and the Holy Ghost. Have you ever wondered, how can they do that? You weren't trying to be a judge, but you know, you're not blind either. How can that man be like that? In 2 Peter chapter 1, he said, Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Anybody? You haven't tuned me out already, have you? Anybody? No. I said, man, after all that, I don't feel like I've obtained any faith. We have obtained like precious faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, well, he's writing to us. And it's through the righteousness of God, our Savior, not our own righteousness. Amen. He said, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God. So what do I get if I take it upon myself to learn about him, to seek him? I get grace and peace, all things that pertain to life and godliness. I'm going through these verses right here. Glory and virtue, exceeding great and precious promises, so that by them I might be a partaker of the divine nature and escape the corruption that is in the world because of all the lust that's in the world. If you want to escape, if you want to get away from all of that, learn of him. Increase your knowledge of God. Hide the word of God in your heart. Because if you do not hide the word of God in your heart, and you do not seek him, and you do not believe, you will be a victim of the world and of all its lust. And to godliness, brotherly kindness, add all these things to your faith. Temperance, knowledge, temperance, patience, godliness, brotherly kindness, charity, for if these things be in you and abound, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind, and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you shall never fall. And as they come in the conclusion of the service tonight, I think, and it's not a rhetorical question, is there anybody here that does not want to fall? Just a few of you. The rest of you do. I'm asking you. If it wasn't possible to fall, it wouldn't have warnings in the Bible. Amen. And so how do I keep from doing that? Just told you, I read it to you. Add these things to your faith, and chiefly the knowledge of God. Getting to know him and the power of his resurrection. To know him is to love him, Pastor Davis used to say. And to love him is to serve him. Amen. Preachers, people are coming to the altar now. Why don't you come too? Increase your prayer life. Increase your knowledge of God. As they begin to sing and to play, how about you tonight? Do you want to know more about him? Get curious tonight. Say, Lord, I'm going to ramp up my desire for the knowledge of the word of God. Harden not your heart.
That a king would know.
Harden not your heart. It's in the day of provocation.
That he would know me and use me just the same. I know I'm not perfect.
Father, thank you for your word tonight. Let our hearts be soft, malleable in your hands, oh God. As we make ourselves available to you.
We see
sing.
We know you're coming soon. There is so much to do, but the laborers are few.
God bless you.
I hear you calling. I will answer. Use me, Lord, have your way.
I want to be your Lord. to him.
Sunday morning in the house of the Lord.